Hello, this is Dana Cadman, Director of Communications and Information Services for the EPC, and today we're going to talk about training in the series How to Build a Communications Team. This is the third part in the series, so if you haven't seen the first two parts, you probably want to review those before getting to this part. But today we're going to talk about how to provide training to your team and help them improve their skills. First thing we want to do in looking at training is find out what skills does your team need, and we're going to do what's called a skill gap analysis, which is very simple actually. It just looks at what skills do you have and what skills do you need to accomplish the tasks you want to accomplish, and then look at where you have gaps or what skills you're missing, and that helps identify training. So to do that, like I've just kind of outlined here, first off, create an inventory of what skills you have, and that's basically go to each team member. Or, you know, if your team is small enough, you can probably do this on your own and go through what skills do you believe they have. And not list just the skills they have, but also what's their level of expertise. And you can use whatever ranking system you want. You could use a scale of 1 to 5, or you could say novice, medium, and expert, or, you know, whatever terms you want to apply. And after you've created this list of skills, now look at the type of projects that you want to take on. And that's not only what are the projects you're currently working on, but also kind of what's on the horizon, what's been proposed to you, what have your team members suggested, or just on your own, what kind of dreams have you had for your team? And then you identify the skills associated with those particular projects. So then you compare the skills that you have to the skills that you need and identify who needs what type of training. So you may find that, you know, you want to start blogging. Well, you already have somebody who has some web building skills. But to do blogging, you know that you need a good writer also, and you don't really have anybody on your team who's an expert writer. Now, you may not have any people with writing skills, in which case you might be better off to go off and recruit someone who has those writing skills. Or you might have someone who's, you know, okay, but really not at the level that you would hope to have for a blog, so that's an opportunity for training to get them up to that level that you would like to have them to have before you start blogging. And then also you want to look at who can share training, meaning who on your team maybe has skills that another team member needs, and that's an opportunity for mentoring or at least job shadowing, is a marketing term for that. Or you may find that somebody else in your church has a particular skill and they don't have time to join your team, but they do have time they could put aside to train someone. So just because you lack a skill in a particular area doesn't mean that you have to go off and buy a book or send someone to a training class. Those are both good ideas. Plus there's a lot of on-demand training that you can download from the internet. But you might have those skills within your church or even your own personal network of friends and family and, you know, other coworkers if you work outside the church, who might have the skills that can train your team members. All right, now the two types of training I want to look at are skills training and tools training. Now, skills training are the general, non-tool specific type of training that can be used in a broad general area of applications. For instance, two-dimensional composition, or, you know, what most of us call art, or graphics. Graphics can be used on Sunday bulletins or newsletters, they can be used on web pages, they can be used to edit photographs, they can be used to create banners. So learning art is a more broad-based skill that can be used in many different areas. The problem with skills is that they take longer and learn to teach than tool-specific training, and they also require practice. You simply don't just take a class in art or photography and then, you know, you're an expert. Certainly during the course of your class, your skill will improve. But these general skills require more and more practice to really improve your craft. Where what most people focus on when they think of training is tools training, which is very specific to a particular kind of tool. For instance, learning Photoshop, meaning you're already a photographer or you're already an artist, but you're not familiar with Photoshop and you need to learn what are all the menu options and what are the different ways in which you can manipulate photos or create images from scratch. That knowledge can be transferable to another graphics editing type program like Photoshop, but there's a relearning curve because it's not a general skill, it's very specific to that tool. The cool thing about tool skills is that they're more quickly learned and taught because you can learn a little bit and apply it, and learn a little bit and apply it. You don't have to, like in writing, for instance, learn general composition, learn punctuation and grammar, and, you know, really improve your spelling, things that, again, take a long time to practice and learn. Whereas learning a word processor, you know, learning how to make text bold or italic, or learning how to cut and paste paragraphs from one area to another, once you learn it, you repeat it a couple times and you pretty much have that skill. The difference here, I like to equate things to carpentry, is that operating a table saw is a specific skill, it's a tool skill, but learning how to operate a table saw very well doesn't necessarily make you a carpenter, because a carpenter needs to understand what type of wood you select, when is it appropriate to use this, what kind of joint do I need, whereas somebody who knows just how to operate a table saw might be very quick and fast at making very precise cuts and joints and such, but they're doing basically what the carpenter is directing them to do. So that's the difference between skills training and tools training. And as you do your skills gap analysis, you're going to need to find out which types of training your team needs. Because if they need tools training, again, that can be learned very quickly and you can bring people up to speed. Whereas skills training, you might be better off trying to recruit somebody who already has that skill rather than trying to train someone up in that skill. Now, where do you find training? I've mentioned some of these books, okay, readily available. You can find them, you know, at your library, bookstore. Somebody might have them on a shelf. The problem with books is that, you know, it takes a while to consume them because you have to sit down and read them. Now, some of the books I've enjoyed is the 24-hour series, like Learn Photoshop in 24 Hours or Learn Web Page Creation in 24 Hours. Now, it's a clever title because they make it sound like you can learn it in a day, which you could technically if you stayed up for 24 hours. But what they do is they take these books and they divide them into 24 chapters that are meant to be read and practiced within an hour's time. So basically, over the course of a month, you know, if you practice an hour a day, you would end up finishing the book. Videos, they're available. They're usually a little more expensive than books, not always. But the thing is that they can be more quickly consumed. And the nice thing is that with a book, only one person can read a book at a time, unless someone reads it in the morning, someone else reads it in the afternoon. Where the videos, you can actually have a half dozen people sit down and watch the same video and learn a skill or a tool-specific task very quickly. And usually you'll find that videos generally tend to go toward the tool-specific operation, but again, like I said, they're more quickly consumed by a larger audience. Then, of course, you got webinars and seminars, you know, which is what this pre-recorded presentation is basically a pre-recorded webinar. If you look on the internet, you'll find plenty of free videos available on a variety of topics. Now, the quality will vary, and oftentimes you do get what you pay for, but I've seen some great free resources, and also I've paid for some resources that weren't that good. So, just, you know, caveat emptor there, buyer beware that, you know, sometimes you don't always get what you pay for, whether you're paying for it or not. But webinars and seminars can be great. Some of the all-day seminars offered by American Management Association or Paget Thompson, some of these are great resources as well. Of course, that means you have to go someplace, you have to allocate some time. Also, the materials can't be readily reviewed. Like a book, you can reread a chapter, a video, you can go back to that specific spot. With a webinar or a seminar, you need to be taking very good notes, unless it's a situation like this one where it's pre-recorded and you can, you know, review it at your leisure. So that's really all I have to say about training. You know, it's an important aspect of team development. It's something that you should continue to do. I encourage you to review it at least annually, if not quarterly. But you know, if possible, you know, review it quarterly with your team. Find out what they'd be interested in learning, and to the best of your ability, provide them with that training, because people love it when you invest time in them. They feel valued. They feel honored, and it builds loyalty and capability and capacity in your team. Now, the discussion for this is available on EPC Community. There's a conversation going on there about developing communications teams. So log in there and post your questions if you have them, or comments, either on other people's comments or on this presentation. If you have other resources related to training, I would love you to share those. And if you don't already have an EPC Community account, when you log in, it's going to ask you for an access code, and that access code is EPC1981, and that's capital E, capital P, capital C. That's case sensitive. This video, if obviously it's available on YouTube, but you might be looking at the slides, And so here's the YouTube channel. We're available on Facebook and Twitter. We're also on Flickr, Google Plus, and Pinterest. So let us know if you follow us there. And if you have a great, nice photo of your church, please send it to me at dana.cadman@epc.org. I'd love to add it to our Flickr and Pinterest pages. Again, I hope this presentation has been useful to you, and I look to seeing you on EPC Community.